There's
worse
zeros,
not bad.
Yeah.
I mean, it's better.
That's the bottom line on that.
Yeah.
I can promise Lonnie that I'll be a drunk
friend. Unless they cancel vanilla, in which case.
You guys right to go? First things first, there are 19,538 confirmed aggregate cases of coronavirus in Victoria. That is 63 new cases since my update yesterday. I'm sad to have to report that there have now been 666 Victorians who have lost their life because of this global pandemic. That's an increase of 5 since yesterday's update. 2 of these deaths occurred prior to yesterday. These include 1 female in her 80s, 3 females in their 90s, 1 female in her 100s, and we send our sincere sympathies and condolences to each of those 5 families. This will be a very difficult time for them. All of those deaths are linked to aged care outbreaks. There are 283 Victorians in hospital, 19 of those are receiving intensive care, and 16 of those 19 are on a ventilator. A total of 2,390,450 test results have been received since the beginning of the pandemic. That's an increase of 18,338 since yesterday, and we thank each and every one of those Victorians for coming forward and getting tested, and we again ask all Victorians with even the mildest of symptoms to please come forward and get tested. It is so, so important in terms of tracking where this virus is and absolutely critical to the roadmap towards a COVID normal that I'm about to outline. There are 4,365 cases of with an unknown source in total, a decrease of 5 since yesterday's report. There are 261 healthcare workers who are active cases. We send our best wishes to them and thank them for the amazing work they're doing right across our state. There are 1,872 active cases in Victoria, so that number continues to steadily fall. In terms of active cases and the metro regional split, as I often make the point, these don't always 100% reconcile because there are some that are still being investigated, but there are 98 cases in regional local government areas that are under stage 3 restrictions. So as we had predicted a few days ago, that number is now below 100 for the first time in quite some time. It was well over 500 not long ago. In terms of communities that we'd had some significant concern about, Greater Geelong has now 19 active cases, just 1 new. Greater Bendigo has 4 active cases, no new, and Ballarat has 2 active cases and no new cases. In general terms, in regional Victoria, those numbers are low, and they do need to be lower, of course, but they are low, and we're very grateful to everyone in regional Victoria for the contribution that they are making. I think that's probably all I need to do in terms of daily data. What I now want to do is, as quickly as I can, as thoroughly as I can, you've all got, I think, packs of information with you. Website is live, call centre is up and running with extra staff so that people can get the information that they need, but I want to take you through the different steps towards that COVID normal. Just before I do that, can I make a couple of broader comments? This job, the great honour that I have to lead our state, every day is filled with decisions that are really, really difficult. Some of them are difficult because they're a genuine 50-50 choice. You're not quite certain which option to choose. Others are difficult because you know what the consequences of those decisions will be. Some of them are indeed heartbreaking. This is not a 50-50 choice. The modelling that Alan will speak to in a moment indicates that if we open up too fast, then we have a very high likelihood that we're not really opening up at all. We're just beginning a third wave. And we will be back in and out of restrictions, in and out of lockdown, before the end of the year. Indeed, potentially well before the end of the year. We can't run out of lockdown. We have to take steady and safe steps out of lockdown to find that COVID normal. We must take steady and safe steps to find COVID normal and make sure that in opening up, we can stay open. Not a situation where we are unable to begin the task of economic repair, unable to begin the enormous task of repairing the damage that this global pandemic has done to communities, to our economy, to businesses, to workers. That will simply be impossible if we are in and out of restrictions for months and months and months and fail to find that COVID normal. That is what is required, and that is why there is no choice but to do this in a safe and steady way. I want to take you now through each of those steps, those safe and steady steps towards a normal, and then I'm going to ask Alan to speak to one of the most comprehensive modelling exercises that we have ever seen in our state, arguably nationally, and a piece of work that has international significance as well. More than 1,000 different scenarios have been put into this supercomputer. We're very grateful to for the assistance of the University of Melbourne and the University of New England. You can't argue with this sort of data. You can't argue with science. You can't do anything but follow the best health advice. Otherwise, we will simply, for a brief period of sunshine, for a brief opening up, but we won't really be opening up at all. We'll just be beginning to lose control again of this virus, and the consequences will be even greater than the difficulties that I know and I appreciate many, many Victorians are experiencing today. So firstly, from 11:59 p.m. on the 13th of September, we'll have to extend out for 2 weeks the current stage four restrictions that Victorians are living under. This is for Metro Melbourne. I'll do regional Victoria in just one moment. So we have to extend. We cannot open up at this time. If we were, then we would lose control very, very quickly. And again, Alan will speak to that in more detail. So, however, there are some changes to that 2 week extension of stage four. Let me run through those now. So from next Sunday, the curfew will be eased and it will be expanded to 9 p.m, not 8 p.m, in recognition that the days are getting longer. That is a small step, but one that we can safely take. Exercise will be increased to 2 hours per day, up from the 1 hour per day. Social bubbles to accommodate those who live on their own, in direct response to feedback we've had from those who have been isolated away from anyone else for a long period of time. We will create those social bubbles so that, much like the way intimate partner arrangements work now, singles, those who live alone, will be able to partner up with somebody else and they'll be able to visit each other. The 5 kilometre rule will not apply, but the curfew will. So it is essentially extending those arrangements for partners who don't live in the same household to those who live on their own. Public outdoor gatherings of 2 people will be allowed, or a household, for up to 2 hours, not the 1 hour of exercise. So it's exercise and or spending time outside, whether it be visiting the park, so on and so forth. And playgrounds will reopen. That is for the 2 week period until the 28th of September. That's the first step. The second step, from the 28th of September, subject to public health advice and subject to the average daily cases being between 30 and 50 at that point, 14 days before, public gatherings increase to up to 5 people from 2 households. Schools, there will be a staged return of school for prep, grade 1, grade 2, VCE and VCAL, as well as specialist schools for term 4. Some senior students will be back from the 5th of October for their GAP test, but from the 12th, the following week, we will have prep, grade 1, grade 2, year 11 and 12 and year 10s for the purposes of their VCAL or VCE studies back, as well as specialist schools. Childcare reopens, more workplaces open, in fact, around 101,000 workers who are currently unable to attend work will be able to attend work in a number of different industries, and you have a breakdown of those different industries and the way in which we have arrived at those industries being able to resume is a very difficult set of judgments that weigh up the public health risk and the economic benefit. We believe we've struck a balance. It is not a perfect balance. There is no such thing. And I know there'll be some industries who are disappointed that they're not on that list, but whenever you draw a line, there will always be different groups on either side of it. We can't, again, as I've said a number of times, and will continue to say for weeks and months to come, This has got to be done in a safe and steady way, and that is a significant number of people who are not at work now, they're not permitted to be at work, who will be able to return. It is not everyone, but it is what is safe, it is what is sustainable. Outdoor pools are reopened, personal training for up to two people per trainer will be allowed. Outdoor religious gatherings of up to five people plus one faith leader will be allowed. These are examples and some features of each of these steps. The third step from the 26th of October, again subject to public health advice, and if the daily average of cases over the previous 14 days is less than five new cases, the curfew will no longer apply. Leaving home, there will be no restrictions on reasons or distances travelled. Public gatherings will increase to 10 people outdoors. You'll be able to have visitors at home, up to five visitors from another nominated household. So much like the singles bubble, there will be a household bubble, you and another home, provided there is your household plus no more than five visitors. Schools, by that stage, will have more to say in relation to grades 3 to year 10. Retail and hairdressing will reopen. Hospitality will recommence, predominantly outdoor seated service. But we will have more to say about that following further consultation and again, the numbers as they present. Sport, there will be a staged return of outdoor non-contact adult sport. That is, I think, a reasonable representation of that step. The last step from 23 November, again, subject to public health advice and case thresholds that Brett can speak to in a moment. Public health gatherings of up to 50 people outdoors, visitors to your home, up to 20 visitors at a time. Retail, all of retail will be open. Hospitality, there will be indoor groups with a limit of 20 people for seated service, a cap of 50 patrons more broadly. Real estate will open with a series of safety measures, further easing of restrictions on sport, particularly community sport. Weddings, funerals, they go to 50 people. And then the COVID normal, after those steady steps have been taken, the COVID normal will see most restrictions dropped, subject to different safety conditions and a phased return to on-site work for those who have been working at home. Essentially, each of these steps are, of course, less than we would like to do. We would all like to open up as quickly as possible. We would all like to find that COVID normal or indeed go back to actual normal as soon as possible. But that is not the nature of this virus. It is wicked in many ways. It spreads silently and it spreads rapidly. And if we look at the experience in Colac over just the last few days, one case has led to 24 people in just a few days in one town experiencing this virus. If anyone listening or watching right now needed any further evidence, and I don't think many people do because they've been living this and they see it around the world as well. One person, one case, less than a week in one country town, 24 people have got this virus. It does spread like fire. And until we put this out, until we contain this properly, we cannot open up, because if we did that, we wouldn't be opening up at all. We would simply be beginning a third wave, one that will do even more damage than this pandemic has already done. I want to get the place open and I want to keep it open. And unless this is done safely and steadily, that simply won't happen. I now want to ask Alan to come forward and just take you through the modelling that sees us unable to open now and confirms for all of us that there is no choice. There is only one option, and that is to do this in a series of steady and safe steps. You can't run out of lockdown, because all you're doing is running into a third wave and we'll all be locked up again. I want a Christmas that is as close to normal as possible, and this is the only way. These steps are the only way that we will get to that point. I'll now ask Alan to speak to that modelling And then I'll come back and take questions. And if there are questions about education, James can speak to those. Health system, Jenny can speak to those. And questions about public health response, then Brett, as the Chief Health Officer, is here to do that as well.
Thanks, Premier. I'll just have the slides. Thank you. So I'll just have the next one. Thanks. So many countries are struggling with control. Some countries haven't finished their first waves. Most others that did achieve early control are now seeing second waves. We may not have seen daily numbers in the thousands like in France and in Spain at the moment, thanks to all the sacrifices that Victorians have made, but it does show how tenuous control can be. The case numbers may be coming down, but it's likely that there are still too many cases in mid-September to open up significantly. So people may ask, why can't we be like New South Wales? Our friends in Sydney aren't in lockdown. The answer is that New South Wales aren't in the same place. There haven't been more than 13 cases a day in New South Wales since early August. At 60 or 100 cases a day in Victoria, we're not even close. If we open up too early, we risk another resurgence and undoing all the work that we've done. Next slide, thanks. So modelling isn't about predicting the future. It can only give us what the most likely outcomes are based on what we know and what we propose to do. What it does allow us to do is to test what-if scenarios. What if we exited to the third step at 25 cases a day or 10 cases a day or 5 cases a day? What this modelling does suggest is that if we relax too early, we risk a loss of control and needing another lockdown. We need to find that sweet spot between the length of the current lockdown and the risk of resurgence. So there are no easy choices here, but this is one that we don't want to make. The worst outcome for everyone is the need to have repeated lockdowns with the uncertainty of never knowing from week to week what we're doing. None of us would be able to plan anything. We've come this far now. If we can just hold on a little longer, we can get ourselves into a better place where we can open up more and still maintain control.
I might now run through regional Victoria and what the next steps look like. So given that acknowledging that there are lower case numbers in regional Victoria, and regional Victoria is essentially a step ahead of metropolitan Melbourne, from 11:59pm on the 13th of September, so next Sunday in effect, public gatherings up to 5 people from a maximum of 2 households can meet. Let me apologise. The regional Victoria essentially has completely different settings as it stands now. They essentially move to step 2 and then we will reassess based on total numbers over a 14-day period. We think that regional Victoria will essentially be able to move to the third step quite soon. It'll be perhaps a matter of weeks before regional Victoria can move to a very different range of settings compared to metropolitan Melbourne. That would mean more shops open, more people back at work, people still working from home in some instances, but relatively normal, certainly compared to the situation that metropolitan Melbourne will have to be in for a longer period of time. Let me find the exact note and I'll go through any further details if you've got questions, but all that information is available. Essentially, we will be able to move a step ahead of metropolitan Melbourne very, very soon. That is, so there's no extension of the current arrangements. They'll be able to move a step ahead of metropolitan Melbourne. I do just want to make one comment in relation to the Geelong corridor. I just mentioned Colac, of course. The Geelong corridor is of some concern to us. And whilst we haven't redefined that, it remains part of regional Victoria for the purposes of these rules. It's fair to say that Geelong is on close watch and we will monitor the number of cases in the Geelong area, just as we have done for many weeks now, to ensure that, for instance, we wouldn't want a situation where if the preconditions for moving to another set of rules for all of regional Victoria were to be held back because of case numbers just in one area, namely the Geelong corridor, we may have to treat Geelong separately. I'm giving people fair warning of that. I'm not actually announcing that. It'll be the product of close watch and close monitoring. But they are the settings, and I'm happy to take any detailed questions on regional Victoria when we get to that. So I think at this stage, we're happy to throw it over to you and to take questions, and I'll throw to each of my colleagues to provide any information that I can't provide.
Premier, can you give us some idea of what will be the next industries added to the permitted industries on the 28th, hopefully?
So there are about 101,000 workers who can come back into the workforce. They currently can't work in the construction sector or elements of the construction sector, and we're happy to get you the detailed breakdowns. They're not all operating at full tilt. There are some limits still. Warehousing, postal services, those sort of distribution services. Childcare, of course, because childcare comes back, and we know how important that is, particularly for a number of people who are currently without childcare but are working from home. Manufacturing, over that group, there's, as I said, about 101,000. There are also some changes that relate to garden maintenance outside garden maintenance. I know that's been something that's been quite topical. Them being not at work has been an important part of stage four delivering what it already has, going from 700 plus cases to 63 cases today. But we think that given the nature of that work and given the settings and they're moving in a broader sense, we think it's appropriate to add those in. So that's about 101,000 in those sectors. The rest of the restrictions over time pick up additional sectors. So for instance, if I can just speak to pubs, cafes, restaurants, bars, there's no point having those venues open if we can't allow customers to move freely and go to those venues, and we simply can't safely have hundreds of thousands, indeed millions of Victorians in metropolitan Melbourne moving around freely, going to have dinner at a restaurant or going to a pub. If we do that, we won't do it for long. We will not do it for long. It'll be weeks before numbers get out of control, and then we have to shut the place down again. So in the main, those sectors, construction, manufacturing, warehousing, distribution, postal services, childcare, and then there is the outside, working alone, no contact with anybody, garden maintenance, landscaping, those types of jobs, James.
Is remote learning, the reality is students in grades 3 to 10 won't be going back to the classroom this year?
Well, the reality is this. These are the facts. These are the announcements we're making. So, week beginning the 5th, there will be some VCE students that'll be on site doing their general assessment test. There will then, so remote and flexible learning other than for those purposes will continue for that week for everyone. This is in Metro Melbourne. Regional Victoria, the schools go back on that timeline as per normal, all years, all schools. In terms of, again, continuing Metro Melbourne, from the 12th, Monday the 12th, it will be Prep 1, 2, Year 11, Year 12, Year 10, where they're doing VC, VCAL, and specialist schools in recognition that it is very, very challenging for flexible and remote learning for kids that have got special needs. That's what we know and can announce today. In terms of grade 3 to year 10, remote and flexible learning, learning from home continues. We aim to be able to, subject to the data, subject to the number of virus cases, we aim to try and get kids back, but that's got to be done safely, and it can't be in a way that would ultimately put at risk all the other goals of getting the place open by the time we get to Christmas. So I'm not saying no, but I'm not in a position to be able to outline a timeline and say yes right now. If those settings change, then as we have all the way along, Rich, we will try and provide parents, in fact, we will provide parents with as much notice as we possibly can. That's Metro Melbourne, regional Victoria, where we'll see the school year pretty well at the beginning of term four unfold as it normally would. But I might ask James to speak to that because, of course, it does have impacts in relation to early childhood education as well and childcare.
Thanks, Dan. So I'll just take you through what both early childhood and schools look like. So as the Premier outlined, childcare opens from the 28th of September for people that do not require a permit. So a significant a significant step forward for all parents, but particularly of parents as they move into the additional work that is provided in this next stage. Then, based on the modelling, based on the health advice from the public health team, and looking at the cohorts of kids that we need to prioritise, it's the little ones and it's the senior kids and kids with a disability. So in early childhood education, from the 5th of October, sessional kindergartens are open. In terms of the start of term for schools, so the week of the 5th of October, in Metro Melbourne, as the Premier outlined, all students learning remotely, other than the VCE students coming in for the GAT on the Wednesday of that week, and for VCE and VCAL students doing other school-based assessments in that week. From the 12th of October, preps 1s, 2s, years 11 and 12, and year 10 students studying a VCE VCAL, and students with a disability at specialist schools. We will continue, of course, in all our schools to offer on-site remote learning for vulnerable kids, students with a disability. So we'll continue to run that offering in all of our schools. But for the week of the 12th, so that's the week of the 5th, the week of the 12th, Prep 1, 2s, specialist schools, VCE and VCAL. In regional Victoria, we wanted to keep the same settings for our senior students in regional Victoria and metropolitan Melbourne. So regional Victoria in that first week will be the same. So students learning remotely, VCE, VCAL students coming into regional and rural schools for the GAT and for school-based assessments. The week of the 12th, so from the 12th of October to the 16th of October, P to 12, all return to schools. It'll be a local decision at the school level, because primary schools may want the prep students coming in for a day or two and then the other kids coming in. Same with regional secondary schools. They might want to engage firstly with their VCE VCAL students and then get the rest of the cohort in. In terms of arrangements for grades 3 to year 10 in Metro Melbourne, that will be entirely based on the case numbers and the advice from the public health team.
How confident
are you that VCE for Melbourne students won't be further compromised?
I'm very confident, and this was our number one priority for students. As I said, I think at the last time I was at this press conference, for prep to year 11, we've got time. You know, we've got time to address health, well-being, mental health. We've got time to address catch-up learning, and we'll do that in term four. We'll do that in 2021. But for our year 12 students, this is it. This is their last year. So every decision we've made and the engagement of education with the public health team has been, what are the settings we can make sure that this is a year of meaning and that their results are a fair reflection of their ability and their performance. So I'm very, very confident. That's why for that week of the 5th of October across the state, students are at home, so we can concentrate on getting the GAT delivered, the General Achievement Test. This is a very important year 12 assessment to moderate the VCE scores. So the GAT will definitely happen on the Wednesday of that week. And we've had strong engagement with the public health team in terms of making sure that we can deliver not only the GAT, but examinations later in the year in a COVID safe way. The Premier and I announced some months ago confirmation of VCE exams. So they will conclude on the 2nd of December. Students will get their VCE scores and their ATAR ranking before the end of the year, which means for our year 12 students, both VCE and VCAL, at no disadvantage whatsoever with students right across the country. So that's been our absolute focus. And then from the senior secondary, we focus on our kids, play-based learning in early childhood education and prep 1-2s at school.
Kinder resumes from October 5, childcare resumes from 28th of September. What about those kids who do a combined childcare and they do kinder at childcare, for example?
Okay, so it will be the kinder programs within a long day care setting will start on the 5th. So childcare resumes without a permit from the 28th, sessional kindergarten at the start of term on the 5th of October.
Do you expect many parents and children to want to repeat next year because of the massive disruption?
I think it'll be part of the conversation. It's a natural thing. It's a natural question for people to ask. We're not anticipating that there will be an increase in the number of students repeating the year, and for very good reasons. It should really be for exceptional circumstances. The overwhelming evidence is that kids are better off, both academically and in terms of their well-being, if they stay with their age peer group. So that it's only the exception. And it's a really important point to make. You know, this year, our teachers have done a brilliant job. Kids are still learning the curriculum. Now, some students have thrived and some students have struggled, and we know that. And that's why we made significant investment into mental health and well-being. The Premier and I and others, we're giving a lot of thought about what 2021 looks like in terms of catch-up support, additional catch-up support. And we'll make those announcements down the track. But for both kids transitioning from kinder to prep, or students already within school, we're not anticipating the need to repeat a year.
There's obviously a staggered return with prep to two and then 11 to 12 returning to school early. Will there be consideration for staggering the return of grades 3 to years 10?
As I said, that'll be entirely based on the modelling and on the public health advice. I know, as a parent of a Year 7 child, Grade 6 is a milestone year, Year 7's a milestone year, so I'm really conscious. We understand, I've got kids of my own, Premier's got kids, school-age children, we understand what impact this is having on parents and students. We want every child back to face-to-face teaching, but we simply cannot do that now. It's not a choice available to us. There may be decisions we'll make in the future, but that will be entirely based on the case numbers.
So there could potentially be a case for, I guess, like grades 3 to 5 returning sooner or later than the rest of the.
I don't want to speculate. All we can announce with confidence today, P2 senior secondary, for all those students, whether it's in groups or whether it's the entire cohort, grade 3 to year 10, that will be entirely based on the case numbers and how we're travelling.
Just looking at the roadmap, are we basically going for an elimination strategy now, given the last step requires no new cases for 14 days?
Now, Lundy, the important thing to remember in relation to the difference between suppressing this virus and trying to eliminate it, it's not so much case numbers, it's what you do once you get a case. So New Zealand had a strategy where they were after zero cases and to maintain zero cases forever. And when you get a case, 3, 4, 5, whatever it might be, then you automatically go back into lockdown. That is not the strategy. That's not the National Cabinet agreed strategy. There are always more cases out there than those people who come forward and get tested. So you always got to assume that there are some cases out there. If we can meet all of these thresholds along the way, and I might ask Brett to speak to these thresholds in a moment. If we can meet all these thresholds along the way and we're confident and the modelling supports the fact that we can, we'll also use some common sense. If your 14-day average was going along well and then you happen to have one contained outbreak on the 13th day, for instance, that threw your numbers out, we'd always reserve the right to apply common sense to this. Similarly, once we get to that COVID normal, one case or one outbreak would not be enough for us to then reimpose rules. We are about managing this, but the only way you can effectively manage it, so that's a suppression strategy rather than trying to wipe it out completely and forever, is to get these numbers down to such a low level that it's a fair fight, that contact tracing, massive team, highly skilled team, doing an amazing job. But if you go and ask them to chase 400 or 500 cases a day and a couple of thousand close contacts, that gets really, really hard. Really hard. In fact, I don't know that that can necessarily be done and sustained day after day, week after week, and keep the place open. You can chase those numbers if you've got everything shut down, but that's not what we're talking about here. We're talking about a pathway, a roadmap, a series of steady and safe steps to open up. We don't want to keep the place closed down for a moment more than we have to, but No public health response, no contact tracing will work if you've got the whole thing out of control, and it's why many countries around the world essentially stop contact tracing in any meaningful sense when they get above 50 cases. That's not what we're doing here. So the strategy remains the National Cabinet agreed strategy, and I've confirmed that with the Prime Minister this morning.
Are you worried about compliance going forward?
I want to thank every single Victorian for the contribution they've made, and these, if the sacrifice that every Victorian has made is to mean anything, is to count for something, then we have to open up in a safe and steady way. We can't do any different. There's no other option. Much as I'd love to stand here and be able to say that we can open up every part of the economy in 2 or 3 weeks' time, every part of the community in 2 or 3 weeks' time. If you do that, then we will simply be in the midst of a third wave, we'll lose control again, and we'll be locked down again. So I want to open up, but I want it to stay open. I want us to find that normal. And so 2021 looks very, very different, than 2020. It's not safe to protest, it's not smart to protest, it is selfish to protest, and what's more, it is unlawful. I don't know that I could be any clearer than that. And frankly, any behaviour from anyone that contributes to more virus, not less, more restrictions, not less, that is in no one's interest.
Even people who aren't protesting, though, who want to do the right thing, yes, are reaching the end of the limits.
Absolutely, Laura. I'm not questioning that at all. People want this over, and so do I. But what we've got to avoid here is the notion that just because we want it to be over, we act as if it is, when clearly the evidence tells us otherwise. You can't pretend your way out of this. You've got to be driven by the science, driven by the data, driven by the best of medical advice. You've got to defeat the second wave and do it properly. Otherwise, you're just beginning a third wave. And again, make the point. The third wave will mean we can't do the economic repair that people desperately want us to do. We can't get people back profitable. We can't get people back to work. We can't find that normal. The other point I just want to make, and you know, this is not a criticism, but I get there's a bit of a tone around the place that, oh well, this is only killing older people, and they were, you know, they're at the end of their life anyway. Well, I don't think that's a fair point to make. They're not numbers. They're people's parents and grandparents, their uncles and aunts, all of those things. And it doesn't just have really significant impacts for older people. It's not something anyone wants to get. There's a lot of people who are struggling with this, and it's not a common cold you shake in a week. But the other point I want to make, so that everyone at home knows and understands this, in October last year, there were 1,000 Victorians who had a stroke and needed to be hospitalised. In October last year, there were 1,000 Victorians who had a heart attack and needed to be hospitalised. If this gets away from us because we want it to be over so desperately that we kind of kid ourselves that it is, and we open up too soon, it won't just be COVID patients who we'll struggle to provide for. It'll be other patients of all ages, of all backgrounds, from every single family who will need care and support. And the great fear and the likelihood would be that we wouldn't be able to provide those people. And that's just two conditions in 1 month, and that's 2,000 people. We wouldn't be able to provide them with what they'd need. That's not to talk about premature babies, urgent cancer surgery. The list goes on and on. We've got to find a way to see this thing off and then open up and stay open. Find a normal and make sure that that's a lasting normal, not something that's there for literally a few weeks.
Where does elective surgery sit in this program?
Elective surgery is not a matter that we have finalised yet, Michael. That's a very important question. I know there are many people out there who've had to have their surgery cancelled, not just public patients, but private patients as well. And as a government that has prided itself on, you know, doing more elective surgery than the state's ever seen, it's not an easy choice to make. However, very soon, the Minister and I will outline a timetable. Again, it'll be subject to advice and case numbers. But it won't just be a timetable for the resumption of surgeries that were booked and had to be cancelled. It'll also be a blitz and a plan for us to catch up. That plan will have to run into 2021, but we'll have more to say about that soon.
You're asking Victorians or Melbourne needs to be patient, and I get that, but I think one of the most challenging things for people is not being allowed to have visitors in your home,
Yes. Singles
aside,
yes,
until possibly the end of October. That is going to be very hard for lots
it
of
is
families.
Incredibly challenging.
What's your message on that
front? It's incredibly challenging. The message is all about what we know about this virus, so it's about the facts. What we know is that the second wave in large part is about the transmission of this virus between workplaces and families in their homes, and the virus bouncing back and forth. We can have COVID-safe plans, and part of this roadmap, part of these steps, is every business across the state having a COVID-safe plan. Rigorous monitoring, proper enforcement of those rules, and I want to thank industry for their involvement in developing those and in their compliance for those that are open now. But it is very difficult. It is very difficult for us, and it's just not smart to assume that everybody acts as formally at home as they do in a much more formal setting. People let their guard down. It's also about movement. The basic maths of this, Michael, is if you have hundreds and hundreds of thousands, indeed millions of people moving around the community, when you've got as much community transmission as we've got, and we haven't yet hit these targets, these very low numbers, like our daily case average for the last 14 days is 100 odd. If you open up at that level, you're not open for long. Even at 63, even at 25. At 25, we'll finish up 60% chance this doesn't work. You open at 5, do it steady and safe, and the risk of having to go back into lockdown goes down to 3%. So a 97% chance that this will work. That's why when I say there's no choice, and that as tough as this is, the difficulty in my decision making has not been, oh, this is a genuine line ball 50-50 call. It's not. We either do it this way, or in fact we won't be opening up at all. We'll just have a short respite from these rules, which I know and appreciate and understand are incredibly difficult, incredibly difficult. But there's no alternative, unless of course we want to have, as I said, just a couple of weeks of relative freedom, only to have to then plough back into lockdown after lockdown after lockdown, and no COVID normal, and 2021 that looks very much like 2020.
Are the low thresholds due to the fact that the contact tracing in Victoria is not up to scratch, and the infection control at some hospitals aren't up to scratch?
No, I wouldn't agree with those statements, and the reason I wouldn't agree with those statements is that they're basically wrong. We contribute to the national dashboard on contact tracing. We provided to each of you the data as of yesterday, and I'm going to try and get that data to you as often as we possibly can. We are getting to almost 100%, to just slightly under 100% of close contacts within 48 hours. We are getting and interviewing into the 90%, so 91, 92, 93% of positive cases, the interviews conducted within 24 hours. Let me explain to you why there might be 5 or 6 or 7% of people who we can't get to in 24 hours. There are a small number, it's very small, but in percentage terms, everything is quite small because the numbers are coming down. On any given day, there are one or two people who will not consent to being interviewed. On any given day, there are a handful of people, so rough numbers, of those 63 positive cases, who we are, as we speak, our dedicated team is working night and day to contact those 63 people and to interview them. There'll be one or two, I don't want to be interviewed. There'll be one or two or three who cannot be found. And despite ringing as many times as we can, despite door knocking, and that's happening to every single close contact and every single positive case, we won't be able to find them at home or contact them, speak to them within that 24-hour period. Those numbers have steadily come down and they will continue to improve. The good thing here though, Rich, is we are not we've not modelled this based on some unrealistic improvement. Any improvements that are made, and I think they'll be at the margins, will assist us in delivering what we've outlined here. On the issue of infection control in hospitals, well, or aged care, I don't want to run a commentary on aged care.
Isn't that the big problem? Like the numbers are being driven a lot by aged care.
Yeah, well,
isn't there some way you can ring fence these places?
And well, let me just speak to that, to the issue about hospitals first, and then I'm happy to come to aged care. What I'm saying is I'll try and be factual rather than giving you my views on the sector and all those sorts of things. That's not productive. In terms of hospitals, we're doing everything we possibly can to provide PPE and practices in hospitals that are as safe as they can possibly be. The number of hospital-based infections, the number of health workers, that have become infected and been furloughed is not a reflection on PPE compliance or how seriously our health professionals, our health heroes, take this virus. It is absolutely a commentary on how wildly infectious this is. Think about this for a moment. People working some double shifts, they haven't got one mask on, they've got head to toe PPE, they are at the highest levels anywhere in the world, and yet they are still contracting this virus. Not all at work, but some at work. That speaks to just how infectious this is. On aged care, where we are today, as a result of a partnership where people are not worried about what political party you're from or what government you're from, but we're all working together, we are in an infinitely better position today with aged care than we have ever been. That's because we're working together, and I'm confident that the stability that's come to aged care can be maintained. But if this was simply, to put your question another way, if this was simply, okay, just ring fence aged care, just ring fence hospitals, and we can let everything open up, well then of course we would do that. We absolutely would do that. But that's not an option, because every healthcare worker lives in a family, every aged care worker the same, people move back and forth, we've got community transmission, we've got sewage testing in Apollo Bay today that has confirmed for us that there's at least a case down there, there's virus down there, there's no confirmed cases down there, none whatsoever. So this is out there in the community at higher levels than the data will tell you, because not everybody who has symptoms gets tested. If it was as simple as just locking down one sector or going to even extreme measures to try and protect one sector, then that's exactly what I'd be announcing today. And that's what the doctors would have advised me to do, and it's what the supercomputer would have said would work.
How about infection controls in hospital? There's been reports of some cases, people going to hospital not for a COVID incident, but, and then taking it home and spreading it. Is that what's happened in Colac?
I might let Brett speak to the specifics of that, and we'd be very careful not to identify any one person. But look, when you've got it in the community, and when you've got it in some high-risk workplaces, and the fact is that hospitals are a high-risk workplace given the infectivity of this, you will see it get out, you will see it move around. That's why you have to be as conservative, as safe and steady as we are now. If you could go faster, if you could do more in any given workplace or any given setting, then of course you would. But that's not the advice.
Contact tracing. You've stood here for a number of weeks now, and we can see from case numbers that contact tracing has improved compared to May and June. And I've asked you on a number of occasions for a number of weeks now, yourself and both your office, of how contact tracing has actually improved, a breakdown of, you know, if there's been any changes to software, I guess how the system has improved. I've been consistently told I'll get that information. I haven't. This is something that industry groups and Victorian people want to know, to be able to have confidence and trust the system.
Well, I think the fact we've gone from 700 cases to 63 is a pretty good evidence that contact tracing is improving. Could it improve further? Look, every day we're chasing every single thing, some of them very small, that'll get us minutes, maybe hours. So Mayor, on the issue of your request, let me follow that up personally. I'm more than happy to point to anything that we can use to demonstrate why it is, not just over the last week, but over many months, the performance of that team. So it'll be about size. There is a bit of tech that's being used, some artificial intelligence, machine learning type stuff, finding patterns that aren't necessarily obvious. There's obviously more people doing it. The door knocking, old fashioned too. So the best of tech, but also literally knocking on doors, trying to find people. All of those things have played a part. I think part of the challenge will be the attribution of benefit. What percentage of benefit comes from each of those things? I'll ask the question myself, and I have asked it many times, but I'll ask the question in terms of a response for you at the end of our press conference. And if we can get you some more stuff, we will.
I was just going to say, I've been getting messages every single day from members of the public wanting to know the detailed breakdown, and not necessarily.
That's fine. Let me try and chase that up for you. There'll be lots of different factors that have led to that improvement, but what is pleasing is two things. One, we are getting to everybody we can physically get to, not just a call, the actual door knock. Positive cases, and close contacts within the recommended time, and we're beating that for the vast majority of people. But the second point that is pleasing is that there is a culture of continuous improvement in that team, and minutes matter, hours matter. I don't think there's a big step change that'll find you, you know, 12 hours, but there will be small things that we can continue to do. So for instance, the regional public health teams, where we've stood up teams in a number of bigger regional centres, so local knowledge now plays a bigger part in that contact tracing, and some steps we might take in the suburbs of Melbourne. All of those things, quite simple, quite practical, and they will continue to provide even more efficient, efficient performance. The other thing too, if I can allow a third thing that is pleasing about that, the performance of that group, their performance has got better despite the fact that their task has got greater. It's never been bigger in any state at any time, and yet they are getting better and better day on day. But you've got to give them a fair fight. The notion that we say, okay, we want it to be over, so we're going to pretend it is, and you're going to go and chase literally thousands of people every day, and it won't be thousands for long, it'll be tens of thousands with all the close contacts. They can't win that fight. No one can. So we just can't do that.
Sorry, Rachel. People refusing to be interviewed. How many people are
tiny numbers
to be interviewed, and what action can you take against people?
Oh, well, I don't know that there is much action we can take against them. We can just provide advice. And I don't use the example to be blaming those one or two people. And I'm not saying that's contributing to our case numbers in any meaningful way. But when you get down to the fine numbers of, okay, there's 63, to get 100%, that means all 63 need to be found, all 63 need to agree to an interview, all 63 need, for instance, if one of those people is in an aged care facility and you know, is not in a position because of psychogeriatric issues or whatever it might be, they're not in a position to consent to an interview. It does get hard to get 100% of any group, and particularly when the group gets smaller and smaller and smaller. So it's not a matter of attributing that to our case numbers. I'm just trying to explain to Rich's question, getting to 100 is actually quite tough, but we're getting close.
Given that you mentioned those refusals, is your office able to provide some data on
that? Oh, we can give you a sense of it. Yeah, sure.
Thank
it's literally, it's like 1%, maybe 2. So it'd only take a couple of people, even one person, to say that off a 63 base, and getting to 100%, you can't then, can you? So again, it's not a matter of, I am responsible to make sure that system works as well as possible, right? Not quibbling with that. I'm just trying to explain the breakdown of, say, the 63. You only need one person to say, no, I don't want to be interviewed, and all of a sudden, you can't deliver the 100%.
Just on the system.
Yes.
The single people bubbles, how's that going to be policed, or is there a register? I mean,
sure. The fact of the matter is this, short of having a police officer knock on every door in the state, we can't be absolutely certain. What I'm doing is I'm asking people, in recognition of the challenge and the difficulty and the great sacrifice that people who live alone, the great contribution that they've made to this point, I'm asking them to follow these rules. You can link up with someone else. They don't necessarily need to be in the same circumstances as you. They can support you though. 5Ks doesn't apply. It's like the intimate partner arrangement as we've had all the way through. It's pretty sensible, and I think that people will so value that they'll do their level best to follow those rules, and I'll be very grateful for that. The same thing will apply when we move to family bubbles or household bubbles, so that you can link up with one other family. Your household can, if say there's 7 people in your household, you can link up with another household. You can have no more than 5 visitors to your home, but you can then have that level of social interaction that, as Michael said, people are craving. I get it, I understand it. We all live in families, we all live in households, and none of us have had visitors for a very long time, and it's tough. It's really, really tough. You know, but I'll put it to you this way, notwithstanding some of the metro regional things, you know, it was my mum's birthday just recently, and you probably shouldn't do this, but I thought to myself, how long is it since I've seen her? I haven't seen her since Christmas. Now, just like lots of other families, I'm not, no special pleadings from me, I'm just trying to use a example. Between bushfires and this, I haven't been up there. I want to get there this Christmas coming though. I want all of us to stay the course, so that we can all have something approaching a normal Christmas. And what the data tells us, what the scientists tell us, and the doctors, and frankly, common sense, if we do this too fast, If we run to open up, we won't be open for long. They do. There is a likelihood that at a point in the future, we don't need to have compulsory masks, or we alter the settings in which you need to use them. But I've got to say this, I'm going to be a holdout on this. I'm going to say as long as we can, my personal view, of course we'll follow the advice, but my personal view, high reward, low cost. So high benefit, low cost. Yes, it's a pain, no one enjoys it, but compared to being locked at home, compared to people becoming gravely ill or becoming ill and not being able to shake this, and that's presenting in lots of people these days, I think masks are something that we should continue to do. We'll follow advice, of course, but I've got a pretty conservative view on masks. I think they are playing a part, and arguably, when we're out and about, we're moving around, the numbers are low and we've got no tolerance, we've got to keep them low, the masks really come into their own. They might even be worth more to us then. It's a bit like the app, James. You know, when everyone's at home, the app isn't really a thing. It's not doing its job because we're not actually letting it. But look at the Crossroads Hotel. This is very much like the sewage testing. It comes into its own as well, as a trying to get surveillance and a picture when people are starting to spend time with people they don't know, when people are in larger groups. The Crossroads Hotel example in Sydney, we will get to that point again where we'll finish up. Hospitality will be open and we'll finish up with a case. And that's where masks will mean there are less of those cases, and things like the app will allow us to have even better contact tracing and to connect dots that are not apparent, that you spent time with someone that you don't actually know.
Premier, last time Victorians did the right thing and they were let down by problems and mistakes made by your government. You're asking people to be locked down for longer again this time. What guarantees in response can you give that you won't make big mistakes again?
Well, first thing to say is that I apologise for the circumstances we find ourselves in. I apologise for the reality that we find ourselves in. But we can't change that. We can't simply wish that away. This job, the honour that I have to lead our state, is about making tough calls, but it's also being accountable. And I'm 100% accountable for where we find ourselves, but equally, I'm accountable for getting us to the other side of this. And pretending it's over because we want it to be, that is not something I will do. That is not leadership. That's something very, very different. And as hard as this news will be for so many Victorians today, it's the only option. And I would, with the greatest of respect to everyone, what would be even harder news would be to convince yourself and think, because the government of the day told you this is over, we can go back to normal, only for me to have to stand here again in just a few weeks' time and say, we got it wrong, it's back again, and now we have to shut down again. That would, I think, in some ways be even harder news than what I'm delivering today, as difficult as today is. We have seen improvements across the board. That's not to say every area needed to, but to what you're driving at, we've seen improvements across the board. It's a big team. Everyone's working as hard as they can. But as hard as all the people who've got an official role to play, as hard as they're working, the really hard work and the work that makes the biggest difference is the work and the contribution and the sacrifice that every single Victorian is making. And I want that to count for something. I do not want to simply pretend this is done and then have everything that Victorians have given frittered away and meaningless with another lockdown. And when I say lockdown, it would be probably multiple lockdowns, because a third wave will be even more challenging than the second. It just will be. We've got to stay the course on this. See it off, defeat it properly, open up and stay open. That's what I'm aiming to do. And that's what I'm spending literally every moment focused on.
At what stage, Steph?
So we'll go to Michael was next, I think.
Well, Premier, it is a long road back for the hospitality sector, and even though the weather improves, for a lot of cafes and restaurants, outdoor dining just simply isn't practical. Are you therefore resigned to a sizeable number of cafes and restaurants in Melbourne going under before the restrictions ease for them?
No, I wouldn't say that. We'll have more to say about support for businesses that are affected by this. That's not for today, but we'll have more to say about that soon. Michael, I would say that there are a number of businesses, and again, this is not, I'm not having a go at local government, just in case anyone jumps to that conclusion, but there are a number of businesses for whom outdoor dining, outdoor drinking, so whether it be seated or service, is not practical because they have a number of rules. If you look at some cities around the world, the car parking, the curbside car parking is gone. The footpath has been restricted. They have put plastic dividers between tables and they are seating more people than they could ever seat inside the cafe. We are looking at all of that. Now, we've had some consultations with the industry and they would of course prefer to have everybody back inside. That is not possible in the first instance. There may be some of that, but it will have to be predominantly outside. I've had conversations with the Lord Mayor, I've had conversations with colleagues and industry. I think that the hospitality sector is going to look very different. We may close streets, we may remove parking, we may go to those dividers, we may move quite a significant amount of activity outside the venue, but it will still be able to happen. And I think we can make that we can make that work. There are a number of cities in the world that are doing that, and that's what we're focused on at the moment. We do have some time because the numbers simply don't allow us to go to that next week or the week after. But we are confident that some of the barriers, to your point about that's not practical, some of the barriers simply won't be there.
At what stage or step will Melbourne be brought in line with regional Victoria's restrictions? Do we have to achieve like a certain number of cases?
Yeah, it depends on the speed at which regional Victoria progresses, but things do come and become aligned at points, so we have one set of rules. That might be a very good pivot point for me to throw to the Chief Health Officer to take you through the different thresholds and the different gateways, if you like, that we have to go through.
Thanks, Premier. Yeah, certainly, Samaya. The pace at which regional Victoria gets to very low case numbers will mean, in all likelihood, that it'll be ahead of Metro Melbourne. But at some point, Metro Melbourne catches up, and we're all on the same setting. If we can get to that average of five cases per day for a 14-day period, and no cases of unknown acquisition or mystery cases, as we call them, then we'll all be on the same setting, and we'll continue on that setting through the next step and the next step to a COVID normal.
And is that when Melburnians will be allowed to travel to regional Victoria as well?
Yeah, I think that's a natural point at which there's no risk of importing cases to regional Victoria any more than it is from regional Victoria. It's fair to say that the much better situation that regional Victoria is in now is not just the local response that they've had to their cases, which has been fantastic through the regional hubs, but it's also everything that we've done to drive cases down in Metro Melbourne. Obviously, we went into this second wave without regional Victoria having cases, and all of the cases that have occurred in regional Victoria came out of Metro Melbourne. So as we're controlling things here in Metro Melbourne, regional Victoria's on a much, much better footing.
Five cases or less a day, is that obtainable in that time frame? Given we look at New South Wales, it's 10 to 15 cases a day, and we've still got aged care issues and healthcare worker issues. Is five actually obtainable by the 26th of October?
I think so. I think so. The difference in Victoria is that we've got restrictions, we've got policy settings that stop those really significant super spreading events, or those events where even if you're doing the best contact tracing in the world, you're finding close contacts who've already been out and about in settings where they've had contact with another 100 people. So I think it's achievable. We have to see if we get there. We have to get on top of all of those tricky settings like aged care and healthcare and complex work settings where transmission is harder to control. But we also know what needs to happen in those settings, and WorkSafe is working to make sure that they're compliant in those workplaces. And we've seen changes. We've seen meatworks that have had significant outbreaks that have then gone to the really robust prevention programs where they've had another case introduced and no further spread. So we know what works. We've also seen cases of workplaces that have turned people away through their temperature screening who've later turned positive. So they've prevented those significant outbreaks occurring. And we can do that in Victoria, and we can limit the spread with close contacts by the settings that we've got currently.
Was that Colac outbreak the result of a party, teenage party?
I don't know specifically. Clearly, it's had pretty explosive spread. We need to know the full details, but we'll have more on that in coming days.
Come from hospital?
Sorry?
Did the infection come from hospital?
We think it's probably linked back to a health service in Metro Melbourne, yes. It also speaks to the, you know, the fact that you can't just say, close off aged care, close off health services. People are discharged, people transfer for very legitimate reasons.
Just on that point of driving down case numbers and workplaces preventing the preventative measures there, how much of our, you know, declining case numbers is attributed to that and workplaces doing much more as opposed to contact tracing?
Look, it's always hard to know exactly what's been prevented, but I think the change in workplaces has been really significant. I think we've seen very broad cultural systemic changes in workplaces, both in terms of the physical distancing, but also in the cleaning, and also in the way that people have excluded themselves from the workplace with the mildest of symptoms. So we can't know how many outbreaks or clusters have been prevented in that regard, but I think it's very significant, and I think it's pretty clear that industry is doing everything, understanding that this pathway and the timelines for this pathway are as much dependent on those workplaces as anywhere else.
So is it safe to assume that our case numbers have essentially declined because of industry being more proactive as opposed to contact tracing being more productive?
Well, I think it's a combination of everything. It's absolutely contact tracing and the timeliness of that, because people also get captured before they're going to work and before they've got symptoms when they're still potentially infectious. It's also how transmission has been limited between households because of those very difficult constraints on visitors to your home, and everything that's been done in the workplace setting. So it's absolutely the combination.
Can we make trigger points for moving backwards? I mean, there are pretty defined targets for moving forwards. Is it the same for moving back?
It's not necessarily the same moving back. I hope there's no moving back. I think this is a pathway that should relentlessly be easier as we go forward. If there are regional or local cases, I think we can address them on their merits. It's not a case of applying restrictions across the board if we can manage something that's very focal and very localised. So it'll be addressed at the time if we get to that. But I think if there's going to be a step back, it'll be those outbreaks that we just need to manage on their merits, and need to do it with the least disruption and the most focused approach possible.
When stage four was declared 5 weeks ago, what did your modelling say then about where the numbers would be today, next Sunday?
I don't think we modelled out to, you know, 5 weeks later when stage four was in place then. I think we've needed to be able to follow the numbers. It's very hard to model a stage four when there really wasn't an experience anywhere in the world of going through another wave and trying to understand those complex settings where transmission was occurring and the human behavioural response through this wave compared to the first time. It wouldn't have been possible to know where we'd be now.
So by necessity then, 6 weeks was guesswork?
6 weeks was in some respects guesswork. And of course, if we'd gotten to a different point at an earlier point in time, we would have made adjustments as appropriate. And in a sense, the settings that we've got now have been much more robustly informed by everything that we've gone through over the last 5 weeks to know where we're headed.
You think you have, are you more confident of what you think might happen in the next few weeks than you were 5 weeks ago?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Because we've been able to learn so much about where transmission's occurring and have the modelling work against the actual daily numbers to be able to validate it.
So given what's in this roadmap being the later of the threshold or the date, given your modelling, are you expecting that the date will be the later milestone that we hit in each of these? Is that the hope?
No, I think we just need to see how it plays out. We've still got every opportunity to do better than modelling might show, and There's still some uncertainty in that modelling. It's not necessarily going to be the later date if we can do better than that.
Is there any possibility of suburban specific lockdown still, or is that just not worthwhile anymore?
Oh, I think it's going to be very difficult. What we've learned from postcode lockdowns is that people are networked beyond their postcodes, and if you see cases in a particular geography and you think, oh, it's just about the location, you're not understanding that there are networks of cohorts of people or groups within a population who go beyond those geographies. If it's a case of very low numbers in a particular setting, there might be a policy piece that we reflect on about exactly what needs to happen in a particular postcode, but it won't be a lockdown. It's still around 10-15%. So, you know, we're in single figures pretty much on average now.
We have the last step is being met on or by 23rd of November 2020. If we aren't able to meet the threshold by that date,
we will reassess as appropriate. Look, I think we'll get there. This is a slow and steady approach. It's called that for a reason. And I think 23rd of November is a long way out. We'll have every opportunity to see how we're going on the way. But I think if circumstances are different on the 23rd of November, we'll make different choices, but we'll understand that on the way there. And I don't think we'll need to. I think, you know, we're laying out a very difficult path in lots of ways, but it is the least worst option that we can take.
And if we do meet the thresholds before October 26 and November 23, the dates of some of the steps, is there a case for easing restrictions earlier than that date?
Yeah, I think there's always a case for a different approach if we're doing better than is modelled or better than we expect. I think we should always do that, as the Premier said, not a day longer than is required. And I think we take that approach, but we do it on the understanding that we don't want to take chances here. We don't want to ease at a point where we're just increasing the risk unacceptably of not getting to that December that we're wanting.
At what point did you realise September 14 was not going to happen, that stage 4 would have to be extended?
Well, I think it was always clear that we could make some changes on September the 14th, and we've done so. There are changes that we can make. I think it was pretty clear in the last couple of weeks that there were going to be challenges in terms of a much more substantial change, industry change, for example, or judgments about household visits that were much more liberal. But, you know, I think we always knew that we could make some changes that would make a difference in people's lives, but we're not going to be, you know, that substantive jump to a stage 3 that we're familiar with.
But we hoped we're obviously going to go back to stage 3 originally on September the 14th. Was it about halfway through this 6-week period, or like at what point did you start to get a feeling that we're just not going to hit our target here?
Oh, I don't think I knew really well. I knew that the tail would be complex. I knew that it would be very challenging, but you know, there were days when we were dropping by 100 cases per day. That gives you some hope, but there was always an expectation that the tail was going to have complexity, that the chains of transmission that persist are the ones that persist for a very good reason, that they're hard to tackle, they're sometimes hard to identify. So I think we just needed to be open to whatever we were going to be faced with at this point in time.
When will people with family outside of Melbourne or have a second home outside of Melbourne, what stage does that fit into? I mean, can people move to their second home sooner? Under which stage is it?
Look, I think the restrictions, it'll be about the pace that regional Victoria achieves.
Which step is it in those measures?
I don't know that it's been laid out. Obviously, there are the existing reasons to leave home for Metro Melbourne. They will not be going to regional Victoria to an alternative location. So I think it'll be about, it'll be a judgment on when regional Victoria gets to that point, and then when Metro Melbourne can get to the same point in time.
So there's no date yet for people in Melbourne having weekends away in the country down the coast?
Not that I'm aware of, no.
A bit more clarification then around what the difference here. It says that intrastate travel allowed across third step area is from third step, and then the last step says intrastate travel allowed. Can we just get some clarification about the difference between those two steps?
you're referring to intra-state
yes.
travel, so travel within the state?
Yeah, so third step says intrastate travel allowed across third step area. And then last step says intrastate travel allowed. Can we just get some clarification?
I'm not sure I know what that means. But it does mean that when we're in alignment, Metro Melbourne and regional Victoria, then there'll be free movement within the state.
And can we get some clarification as well around gyms? Am I reading correctly that gyms are only open in the last step?
That's right. Gyms are a known high-risk setting. They cause outbreaks. I know gyms are as keen to open as any other industry, and there are lots of mitigations that you can try and put in place in terms of density measures and cleaning and screening, but they still cause outbreaks. They are still high risk inherently because of the exertion that people are undergoing at the gym and the fact that it's an indoor setting. But boot camps are different, and obviously we want to encourage those outdoor activities on those principles that it's a much, much lower risk to do anything outdoors.
And what about retail? Is that because it's indoors or is that because it's a high risk?
Look, it's a combination of indoor activity and the sheer volumes of people that it would apply to be open at an early stage. And again, Cabinet has considered all of the economic measures in relation to it as well. But it's indoors, it would involve millions of people. So that's a significant interaction that even at an individual shop level doesn't necessarily bring significant risk, but overall it's a huge movement.
At what point does the 5K rule end? Like I said, obviously for the single people in bubbles.
Yeah.
But for example, the public gatherings from the 28th up to 5 people from two households, do those households have to be within the 5Ks of each other?
I'm not sure that's been defined at this stage. But I think when we get through the next couple of weeks and we can see that, again, we'll be able to make a judgment about what the levels of activity across postcodes are. We don't want to, again, inappropriately restrict people's ability to see a significant household. So I think we would look to not having that restriction in place, but we do need to see where the activity is occurring in terms of our transmission.
And just on childcares that are allowed to reopen from the second step, will in-home nannies and babysitters also be allowed?
Sure.
This has been an issue that has been very concerning to lots of different people, so I'm going to resist giving you a form of words right now. We'll come back with an exact, precise, as we have done a few times now, an exact answer that everyone can understand. But I think some of the arrangements that have been permissible, they will continue and childcare will be open. Permits go. It's much closer to normal than what it was. There's always an opportunity for us to sort of tweak the language and make sure that we're all clear. So if you give me just a little while, I'm more than happy to come back with an exact form of words. I'm sure it's already written. I just don't have it in front of me and I don't want to make it up because people will read it very carefully, as they should.
Premier, business is already saying that they're really disappointed with the roadmap, that they're not being given enough certainty that businesses are going to go to the wall because of the extension.
Well, again, let me just say, I understand my own background tells me, and I know and understand because I watched my parents do it for every day of their working life, what it takes to build a business from nothing into a very successful business. They then saw that wiped away through no fault of their own. No fault of their own. I've seen that up close and personal. I worked in those businesses from the moment I was old enough to. I thought it was probably a bit early, but I was there doing what I had to do. That's my background. That's the reality that I bring to this. Not everyone knows that, but that's fine. We'll get these businesses open as soon as we can. And I'm disappointed too that I can't have better news for people today. But false hope is no hope, Laurel. The notion of saying to people, yep, no worries, open up next week, when you know, because the science tells you, they'll be open for weeks and then they'll be closed again. That is not an answer. I know people are disappointed. I'm disappointed too that we can't open up faster. But the key point here is to open and stay open, not to be going bouncing back and forth, lockdown, on, off, on. That is not an answer. And when the data is so clear, when the analysis and the advice is so clear, you've only got one choice. As I said, these are difficult decisions, not because they're a 50-50, genuinely you could go either way. It's not like that at all. There's only one option. The difficulty for me, for my team, for all of us, comes from the fact that this will cause pain. It absolutely will, but it's the only option that we have.
Will there be more
consider
financial support for those businesses?
There will be, and I'll have more to say about that in due course.
And what about the mental health?
We have had a series of announcements in relation to support, whether it be for those who are experiencing mental illness and issues of depression and for the very first time, as well as those who underlying mental health problems have been made worse because of the last months, and we certainly wouldn't rule out further support. It's been everything from schools all the way through to extra hospital beds for the acutely unwell and everything in between. So we certainly wouldn't rule out doing more.
And will you consider extending or providing financial support to sole traders?
The day for me to announce that will be when that package of support is ready. I will just say though, because I'm not about trying to, you know, I want to be as clear as I can be. We have, throughout this, we have aligned our support, and this is not a criticism of JobKeeper or JobSeeker at the higher rate. It's just about trying to maximise the aggregate benefit that where our government and the Commonwealth government are on the same page providing support, that support means more. We'll have more to say about that. And because we do understand and appreciate that this is not what many people wanted to hear, but it is the only option.
So sole traders can look forward to some support.
No, I'm not here to make those announcements, and I wouldn't want you to report that because that's not what I've said. We have been aligned with the Commonwealth Government. That is a guiding principle. And there are some supports there for sole traders provided by the Commonwealth Government. I don't want to be here today giving people a sense that we're going to do something radically different there. No, we aren't, but we will look to provide support in very similar terms, or at least to the same groups that we have provided throughout this.
Obviously, Victoria is in a second wave, predominantly caused by a lot of different systemic failures. I guess, is there not a case to make that the Victorian government shouldn't necessarily align its financial assistance with what the Commonwealth is offering because the rest of the country isn't finding itself in, you know, stage four lockdowns right now?
Well, the Commonwealth, that might be true, except for the fact that the Commonwealth government has aligned its settings to hardship. And there's clearly more hardship here than other places. So being aligned with that as a principle makes perfect sense. But again, let's not have a kind of a shadow debate about what I haven't announced yet. I'm going to come back. We'll have more to say. And when we do, then we can have all those questions.
Just on JobKeeper and JobSeeker, I think sure. When you announced stage four, you were saying that you were pleased that the government had indicated it wouldn't drop until hopefully after we were out of stage four. Looking at this roadmap now, particularly retailers and hospitality, will still be closed for a month after it reduces. You said you spoke to the Prime Minister. Did you convey any concerns about that, or what is your view on that
action? I'll have continued discussions with the PM about how we can continue to work together to support people. It's best that I have those discussions in person. I don't think you get very good outcomes by kind of lobbying the federal government in a forum like this. I'll continue to speak with the PM. We had a good discussion this morning. I gave him a sense of what I'd be announcing today. There'd been input at a officer level, if you like, national coordinating mechanism, his department, my department, working together to make sure that we understood various elements of this and we had all the right facts. But today is not a day to announce that, but I will have more to say around support. But it would always be the province of the federal government to make announcements about their policy setting.
There's an asterisk around the spring racing carnival.
There is.
More details.
The reason for that, Laurel, is that whilst we can give people a sense of crowds, we do want to have a specific look at a number of major events that are, you know, it's brand, it's jobs, it's all of those things. So it's a little bit too early to have a definitive number and to be yes or no. So the key point there is just to work through that in a steady way, never compromising the strategy never doing anything other than following the advice, but it's a bit too early, and I know people want certainty, particularly those who run those events. We're taking that offline, if you like.
So it's possible it could still go ahead in some form.
Well, I can't rule it out, but I don't really want to speculate on, you know, whether it's, you know, X thousand or Y thousand. The events will still go on. The question is whether there'll be people there on site watching it, and that'll be to the extent that it's safe. If it was to a day, compromising the strategy for a day at the races for 5,000 people or 25,000 people is not worth it. It's just not worth it. As much as I respect the contribution that sector makes, we've got to do it safe so that, again, 21 looks much like a normal 21 and doesn't have all these hangovers of restrictions on, restrictions off. That's just no way. That's no way for us to spend next year.
Premier, you said that you understand people will be disappointed, that it's really hard, but there will be some Victorians, particularly people in Melbourne, who will have been steeling themselves for a 6-week stage four, rightly or wrongly, who are now going to be shattered to be hearing dates like 26th of November, dates in well down the track without a whole lot of detail.
And if there was another, option, if there was another choice that would guarantee the people were safe, that would deliver you an outcome where you could be confident that we'd be open and we'd stay open, that we could be connected and we would stay that way, then I'd be up here announcing that. And I know a lot of people, this is not what they wanted to hear, but I don't have the luxury of ignoring the data and the science and the medical advice and just saying what people want to hear. That would be a betrayal of, you know, the really difficult task we all have. We've got to find a way to get to the other side of this.
Greg, where does this put this extension, continued steps, put us, Victoria? It's one of the longest lockdowns in, for Brett, sorry, Premier. Does this put Victoria in one of the longest lockdowns in the developed world, I guess?
There are many, many countries that have had restrictions of one kind or another that have been ongoing from February onwards. Clearly, we're at a point where we've got the strictest lockdown in place that Victoria's had. But we do have a path that continues to ease it from next week onwards, progressively right through to the end of the year. There are countries in Europe now that are making choices about a stricter and stricter lockdown, and they'll probably be faced with harder choices as they've got 7, 8, 9, 10,000 cases per day, and may well increase even more. So we are laying out a pathway, and it's long and it's not enough for many, many people, but it is one that progressively eases restrictions as time goes by. The rest of the world are at different points, but there are many, many countries that are now facing the prospect of either having their healthcare system overwhelmed or facing hundreds or thousands of deaths, or the prospect of very significant restrictions that will likely be in place for weeks in those countries. We are trying not to have to face that difficult choice.
On social bubbles, will people or families in Melbourne be able to nominate a person in regional Victoria, for example, to be there?
I think when we're on the same setting, that's certainly the case. But at the moment, those constraints within Metro Melbourne and regional Victoria will continue to apply.
We talked about reassessing regional Victoria in 14 days with the potential to move to the third step. What are some of the trigger points that could get regional Victoria there?
They're really about those case numbers and those average case numbers per day over a 14-day period. We're now looking at 2, 3, 4 cases per day in regional Victoria. So they're kind of on a setting where if for the next 2 weeks it continues to improve, that they'll meet that threshold. But also the threshold of no mystery cases or cases of unknown acquisition over a 14-day period. Again, that's looking reasonable, but we'd need to see what that following 2 to 3 weeks looks like. A mystery case is of greater concern because it means there's transmission out there that you're not aware of. You don't know how to control it in the same way that you do for a known outbreak where you know all the close contacts.
According to plan, we'll be in a position in October where we've got cases in single digits, but we've still got a 9 p.m. to 5 a.m. curfew. Do you maintain that that curfew will be necessary with those cases down in single digits?
I think when we get to that point, that's a point where we can absolutely reassess the curfew. But it's played its role to date. It's obviously sent a very significant message about the serious position that Victoria was in. And from a compliance point of view, the police have been able to focus their resources in areas where they need to.
But you think that incursion on people's freedoms, it's very different to have a curfew when we've got 700 cases to when we've got 9 or 6?
Yeah.
You think it's still necessary when we've got 6 or 9?
I think when we get to very low daily case numbers, its utility will be much, much less, and it's appropriate to review it at that time.
Premier, the opposition says you've betrayed Victorians and taken a wrecking ball to business. What's your response to that?
I'm not here to respond to comments made by. Well, I'm happy to comment more broadly. But I'm not here, and I've never stood here, nor will I ever stand here to be a commentator on people that are not relevant to the work that I'm doing. We've got a job to do here, and we've got to see this thing off properly. Otherwise, this virus will be back, and it will be back worse than it has ever been. If people want to find fault with the fact that I refuse to pretend this is over just because I desperately want it to be, and we all do, well, then that's a matter for them. I don't have the luxury of doing what's popular when I know with certainty that that's not a strategy that will work and that we'll be standing here again in just a few weeks' time reimposing the restrictions that we took off too quickly. We can't run out of these rules. We can't sprint out of it. We have to do it in safe, steady steps so that when we open up, we can stay open. I don't expect everyone to like that. I don't expect everyone, you know, to be anything other than disappointed that this thing is wildly infectious and that this is the only way to deal with it. I'm disappointed too. But you have to confront the reality you face. To do anything else is simply wrong, and I will not do that. I will not, for the sake of being popular, make a decision that I know to be the wrong one, because the data and the science and the experts tell me so.
Tony Blakely, one of the authors of the modelling, he says that we can begin recording fewer than 25 cases even sooner than what you have, you know, what this modelling predicts.
Yes.
If Victoria improved its contact tracing and infectious disease control protocols. So will there be a concerted effort?
I think it's fair to say that there are many different experts around who have many different views. There is a consensus, I think, though, about the fact that this is the only option to take us forward. If, whether in any of the inputs, if you're not assuming improvement, but you can deliver improvement, even very marginal improvements, well, then that's all the better to make it more likely that you reach your targets and potentially to reach them earlier. But the key point there is that this virus is stubborn. This virus is really, really stubborn. And we just can't, any of us, afford to pretend it's over because we want it to be. I know why we want it to be over. You know, it's not, there's nothing wrong. There's no way critical of people wanting this to end, but it's got to be done properly or it'll just be back in a few weeks' time.
Through the 25 case number threshold, because Mr. Blakely also said this morning that was a number picked by the government, and modellers were asked to determine whether that could be a safe number to start easing restrictions. He mentioned that no other alternative scenarios were presented to the modellers.
3, 5, 10, and 25 are the four that were put, and the key point about 25 is, well, we're at 63 just for today. Our average over the 14-day period is 100 odd, so 25 is a reasonable interval. I would have thought that if we could get our cases down to the fortnightly average, down to a quarter of what it is right as we stand here now, then what would that look like? And they've gone and faithfully put in 1,000 different inputs, 1,000 different variables, and they've run all of those. They've run that data, And it comes back and it says that if you opened up at that level, you've got a 62%, 63% chance of being back in lockdown. So that's frankly a difficult choice, but not a hard choice, if you understand. The logic is just there. That is not a strategy. It's a strategy to open up, but it's not a strategy to remain open and find that COVID normal.
And were those case numbers, was that on the advice of the public health?
Absolutely. Team? It's not like I sat down and said, please model these numbers. That's the docs have gone and sat down with people, the data scientists, who these models are so complicated that the computer, and it's got a bit of grunt, it takes 24 to 36 hours to run it. So we'll keep doing that. There'll be more of that modelling all the way through. But again, Samaya, I think the key point here is that modelling in the future will be based on actuals more and more the further along we go. Actuals that will be falling.
A lot of anger coming in from the beauty industry. It's not opening until November 23. A lot of these businesses in these industries already practice with high level hygienic practices. Why is this not in the same timing as hairdressers, for instance? Why the dissension between the two of them?
The Chief Health Officer can speak to that.
Again, these are not just my opinions either. There's an entire public health team who are looking at the risks that are involved. It combines some of those concerning elements of an indoor location, of people being in close proximity, and that's a recipe for transmission. And I know that people can do a number of things to try and mitigate that risk, but again, it's an industry that has settings where the risk of transmission, even with all of those other things that you're trying to do to minimise the risk of transmission, can occur. So the advice to me from the team is that's one to hold off for longer.
How and why is beauty different to hair, though?
Well, National Cabinet made a decision about hairdressing. I think people have a sense that it's a more essential service to be provided for individuals. We've got a personal attachment to that in a way that we don't for some other elements. That may not be my personal view, but I think it's widely held that it's got a more essential element to it.
Is that a very male perspective to hold?
It's not my perspective. I think it was a decision of National Cabinet that had a number of inputs from a number of people men and women together.
Can local council elections still go ahead, or is there a need to postpone them given that these restrictions are lasting longer, making it harder for candidates to go out there and campaign?
Certainly candidates will be challenged to do their traditional campaigning, and it won't look the same by any means. But in many respects, the timing for local government elections is best in October compared to almost any other time. We know that we've got restrictions in place that will continue to drive numbers down so that they'll be at almost guaranteed low levels through October. And with all of the other things that local government elections are putting in place, the minimum workforce and postal voting are all going to make that work with very low risk of transmission. So I think the timing for local government elections is appropriate to continue as is. We certainly don't want to get to a point where we're deferring it into early next year without really knowing what that could look like.
To your knowledge, is Victoria right now under the toughest lockdown in the world?
I don't know. I don't review every other country's lockdown. I know that a number of countries are making difficult choices now to go back into lockdowns, including restrictions on the number of people who visit family homes and the gatherings outside. Spain's going into that, having been through the toughest lockdown in the world. They must be impossible choices for those jurisdictions, but I'm not sure what the landscape looks like across the world at the moment.
Grand final public holiday is scheduled for October 23, and the threshold is October 26 for the third step. Can you move that public holiday or even move this forward, maybe coinciding with that day?
I've tried to confirm as clearly as I can that the Grand Final Friday public holiday will be occurring on Grand Final Friday. So I've got no announcements to make around changing that. Just in relation to gender, which is a perfectly legitimate question, the list of industries, those 101,000, it looks a bit blokey. but the analysis we've done is it's 40% female, 60% male. That has not been the number one guiding principle, but it's a little more balanced than it might look. That's not to say, though, that I think there has been a disproportionate impact from this pandemic and the restrictions that have been essential because of it on women in lots of different ways, and that's something that we will have to work really hard on the other side of this to try and deal with that, much like insecure work, much like a whole range of factors that I think have been exposed because of the rules and because of the fact we've been in this pandemic for as long as we have.
Premier, are you certain that Victoria's contact tracing capacity is on the same level as New South Wales?
I think it most likely exceeds it in terms of the numbers, and our performance is equal to it. So the national dashboard shows you, and they're dealing with but a fraction of the cases we're dealing with, we are delivering performance that is as good as they are delivering, and they're dealing with maybe a dozen cases a day and 30 or 40 close contacts. We're dealing with an infinitely larger number, and yet we're delivering metrics, so against the dashboard, we're delivering performance that is as good. Now, I stress, that's not to say that if we can find a 1% improvement, we won't do everything we can to find that 1%, the minutes, the hour, whatever it might be. That culture of continuous improvement is really, really important.
Do we know at what step or stage allied healthcare will be able to?
I think it's best if we come back and do elective surgery, hospital-based and health service auspiced services, whether they be surgical or medical, or indeed allied health. For safety, there have been some changes made there. There's still provision for people for whom there's some degree of urgency, but again, it's a bit like surgery. No one likes having to cancel that. No one likes having to disrupt that program. But for safety's sake, there's been no other choice. So it makes sense. I think we come back and deal with all those issues as one.
How does this roadmap compare to the previous economic forecast? What impact does this roadmap have on what you thought would happen to the economy?
I think it's about. I'm not in a position today to be able to give you a definitive sense of that. There's still further consultations to be had. There's still further input. So there's some structure here in the out months, but not necessarily detail. So that requires some further work. But as soon as we can update, we will. And again, those predictions become more accurate based on the actual each day's data, each quarter's data, all of those things. But I think when we get to the point of the Treasurer and other ministers and I making some further announcements about support, we'd likely be able to give you some further details on that.
Also on the extensions to exercise.
Yes.
When will playgrounds and sort of outdoor activities be included in that? It says skate parks, but it doesn't specify sort of the more freely accessible stuff.
Yeah, playgrounds, I mentioned those earlier. I'm happy to come back to you in relation to skate parks and some of the other things that sit between a playground and a skate park. Let me come back to you.
Ariel, what's the difference between this roadmap and the one that was leaked 3 days ago? They look quite similar apart from the colour scheme.
No, I don't think that would be a fair reading. As I said, it was a draft document. It had no status. This today was always the day when we would give people as much certainty as possible. We've done that. And again, I understand many people are not pleased to hear this news. I'm not pleased to have to lay out a plan like this. If there were another option, we would absolutely pursue that. But there are many, many differences. Again, I'll leave it to you to compare the two. I'm not going to spend my time comparing a document that is the actual plan with a draft document that has no status and which I never saw, Chief Health Officer never saw. That probably isn't the best use of our collective time, with the greatest of respect.
Business groups hadn't seen this 3 days ago. Were they showed this? Were they given some input?
No, it's not a matter of providing the entire plan. It's about input. So it's about, I think, 30 different roundtables, 280 different groups, not just business, but community groups, workers, unions, very wide cross-section. And there's further industry briefings. As soon as we finish our press conference here today, there'll be some further industry briefings that the Department of Jobs will be taking each and every sector through, to provide them with finer details. Now, some of their questions will be able to be answered, some won't, because we need the passage of time and case numbers to provide that definitive advice, but that's an ongoing process. It'd be quite challenging, I think, to do a total count, but it's literally thousands of meetings over the last 5 or 6 months, and there may need to be thousands more.
How does the traffic light system you announced on Monday fit with this roadmap?
Well,
when does that kick in?
Well, we added in a fourth colour, so I'm not referring to it as a traffic light somewhere any longer. I'm talking about steps. Just to avoid the obvious point you'd make to me that a traffic light only has three lights. I'm being serious. We've moved to steps. There are steps, and then you get to a COVID normal, and we think that's the simplest way, because it has to be done in a gradual way.
Sorry, is this the? I know traffic lights are three lights, but is this the traffic light system you were referring to?
Yeah, this broadly reflects a staged, staggered approach, safe, steady. There's no change in what's been delivered. It's just the words that are given that are used to describe
that's
it.
Changed.
Yeah, sorry, that's the yeah.
With the construction sector,
yep.
And you're going to ease some of the restrictions there. What exactly is that? And is that you're talking about major construction sites? And what are the rules for home renovations and
sure.
tradies who have been able to go on some capacity?
Let me come back to you on the specific numbers, but the way it works, and this will all be in the documents that are up online and that we can provide to you. There's major construction, so major projects. Then there is volume building, if you like, so building homes out in the suburbs. Then there is things like renovations where no one's home. And then there are broadacre land developments where there's not actually a house, but putting in the water, the sewerage, the roads, the power, all of that. There are rules that relate currently to each of those. And some of the percentages, the permissible activity is going up. Some of the numbers and the number of sites, for instance, that each of those different groups of workers can visit in a given day or a given week, they're changing as well. So it's about getting construction up to, it's not normal, it's still curbed, but it's getting pretty close to normal levels. And the combination of both COVID safe work plans, indoor versus outdoor, and economic benefit means that was always a place where we would go early on to try and strike that balance. But it's not the only one. There is some warehousing, postal distribution, childcare, of course, as I listed earlier on. And I think it's around 5,000 outdoor garden maintenance, landscaping type workers also.
Can I ask Professor Sutton a question about masks, please? A few days ago, I had asked whether you'd make mandatory, like surgical masks or these masks that we're wearing. Is that something that you're still considering, just because of now that we know bandanas and scarves aren't as effective?
Yeah, certainly it's still under consideration. The recommendation has remained the same, that if you can get your hands on a three-ply reusable mask, then that's the preference. Then two-ply. If it has to be a single ply mask, then so be it. We didn't want to disadvantage people who couldn't access something. And so having a scarf or bandana is an option for people so that they wouldn't be fined, so that they would have something was a useful position to have. But it's certainly clear that the two ply, three ply mask it will provide better protection. If people have the single use surgical mask, that's a fantastic mask to have. But they are single-use masks, so it's not something that you can provide across the population every day. But we're still considering exactly how we might frame that.
Any other issues?
Can I just go back to Regional? Just you mentioned earlier about the Geelong corridor potentially being treated differently to other
sure.
parts of Regional Victoria.
Yep.
Is there potential in other local government areas where there aren't any cases that they could be progressing further than other parts of regional Victoria, so perhaps not one blanket.
Yeah. Let me take you back to first principles. We have given quite a lot of thought to the notion of having multiple settings in regional Victoria. However, the fact that it is likely, highly likely, that in a couple of weeks, based on about 3 weeks in total from adding the week to come, it is highly likely, not certain, but highly likely that we will meet that case threshold. then we thought we think it's best to try and have one setting across regional Victoria. What I'm doing today, I'm not announcing that Geelong will be treated differently. I'm simply saying to the good people of Geelong, who I think are entitled to have some warning, of the following. Geelong's on close watch. We have got more cases there than other parts of regional Victoria, and we've seen more cases there over a lengthy period of time. So that's not an announcement. It's just that in the event that, not to be getting too far ahead of ourselves, but if you had a set of circumstances, for instance, in a couple of weeks' time, the rest of regional Victoria fits the bill. They've got their numbers down, the numbers are down, except for Geelong, and that to keep Geelong in the same categorisation as, say, Swan Hill would mean that you couldn't open up Swan Hill then, or move to the next step, then we will look to, say, a special treatment for that Geelong region. I would just say it's not just the city of Geelong. It is a corridor, and we have looked at that as a corridor, and today we've talked about Geelong, we've talked about Colac, and that's for another day, but that's what drives the fact that regional Victoria may very soon get to that, to be two steps ahead of metropolitan Melbourne, has meant that we don't think there's a need to put in what can be very confusing, multiple different rules, borders that all have to be patrolled and defended and all of that. We think that one setting is best. Any other issues? Too early to say. When we've got a sense of, as best you can have complete control, but when we move to that point where we can all confidently say we have this actively suppressed, that we've found that COVID normal and we're confident about its longevity, then of course I'll be having discussions with the PM about that.
The interstate borders premier, at what step do you think New South Wales
will? Well, I've made the point a number of times, but to you guys, and to Gladys, to Stephen, to Anna, our greatest contribution to getting borders open is to get our numbers down as fast as we can and keep them down. So, you know, I'd be confident that as we deliver each of these stages, other states will look and be in no doubt that we've brought a sense of control to it, that we're much lower risk than we have been, and then it's ultimately a matter for them. But we'll continue to have very detailed discussions, and the result out of National Cabinet on Friday for South Australia, Victoria, New South Wales to work towards on ag workers, for instance, so someone who lives in Victoria but owns land on the other side of the border in South Australia and wants to go and harvest their crop, the notion that they can go and do that, and the same in southern New South Wales, we're going to work on all those things. So already we're seeing, I think, a pragmatic approach, and other states are working with us very closely. But the best way, the only way, to get our borders open again is to drive these numbers down and keep them down. Any other issues? Thank you very much. We'll see you tomorrow.